The most extraordinary thing about the story to begin with is that they are on the very first transport. Rena is on the first transport to camp. So let's start by talking just about that and about what happened to her.
Well, the new edition, the book came out about 20 years ago and did very well in England, thank you very much, because we have a great country of readers here. And it is extraordinary, the first Jewish transport, the very first mass registered Jewish transport was all young women. And this is the list right here. And it's the original list in the order of collection that you can come up and see. I found this at Yad Vashem in Israel. And then there's this list, which is the SS list. And it's the alphabetical order of the girls that were collected. So the new edition has this new research that that we didn't have before. Things have changed quite a bit in 20 years because of the fall of the wall, because we're opening up into the Eastern Bloc much easier, and research has been able to be shared with the West. And so we have this extraordinary document that informs this book because I found this list. And in 2012, my husband and I went and retraced the transport route from Poprad, Slovakia to Auschwitz, Poland. And while we were there, we sort of met, we had a list that we had collected of names from the Shoah Foundation and from people that Rena knew were on the first transport. And we put together a very small list of about 22, maybe 30 names of women that we knew survived, and then some women that didn't survive who Rena knew. And one of those people on the on that list, her name was Adela Gross. I always cry when I think about her. She was 18 when she went to the camp, and her family survived. And they were at the Poprad station in 2012 and saw our list. We also had a letter there from the chief rabbi of Britain, Jonathan Sachs, sort of blessing our trip. But they saw Adela's name and they contacted me because they never knew what happened to Adela. And now we were able to share. So I know about Adela before she went on the transport now. And they know what happened to her in Auschwitz. And actually, I'm very close with the family now. And sort of out of the woodwork, people are contacting me. I got an email yesterday from a woman who says, my mother died 20 years ago. I think she was on the first transport. And because of this list, I can find out and I can give her mother's name on the list. So there's a lot of new information about these young women that we didn't know. 297 were teenagers. And we know that within the first 6 months, over 50 are dead. Now, the death records are very, very spotty. They didn't keep accurate records for women. They would say, you know, 300 people died, but you wouldn't know if they were men or women. And that happens until about January 1943. When they start to delineate between women and men. So Rena arrives, it's 998 young women come into Auschwitz. They're the first transport. Her sister arrives 2 days later on the second transport. I think there's 798 on that transport. And then it really starts. By September 1942, we have about 17,000 young women in the camps.
And that's the extraordinary thing about Rena, so that her number is 1716, and that means that she was the 716th.
Right. They started counting at 1,000.
Yeah. And that they survived. I mean, end, 3 years and 41 days. So tell me this. How did you become involved in the story? When did you first meet me?
It's when you meet somebody, and as a writer, sometimes a story finds you, right? And it's a gift, and you can't run away from it. And I met Rena, and I think think we just fell in love with each other. We just, we were very, very close for the rest of her life. I was there by her bedside 2 days before she died. And, you know, I just, she was very vivacious. She calls me the very first time. She's heard there's a writer, and I'm living in North Carolina, and she calls me up to see if we want to meet, because she wants to tell her story. And I'm making pierogi, which is the lovely Polish dumpling. And she immediately goes, oh, are you Polish? And I was like, no, I just really like pierogi. And she said it was a sign from God that I was making pierogi, that I should write her story. That's Rena.
And when you meet in 2000 and...
No, 1992 or 1992. Three. Yeah.
She hasn't talked to anybody. And she hasn't told this story. So why does she want to tell the story in 1992?
It's interesting. I think it just had been bubbling up inside of her. I will say of Rena, she's a big talker. And when she died, her husband used to joke that he would go to her grave and I'd say, is she finally listening to you? And he said, no, she's still talking. So Rena was very verbal. And that certainly has part of it. The woman I just heard from, her mother died 20 years ago, never spoke about it. And that's very traditional. We're talking about a generation of women who it's not like today. Oh, I went through something horrible and I want everybody to know. They keep it quiet. A lot of them had their numbers removed. They always wore 3/4 sleeves so you couldn't tell if they had a number. And they didn't want anybody to know. There's shame with it. I think it's embarrassing that I knew a woman who was, her husband was the rabbi in the synagogue, and she never told anybody she was on the first transport. I think that's just sort of this generation of, maybe it's the guilt of surviving or whatever. Rena was not like that. Rena never had survivor's guilt. She said, you know, it wasn't my fault people were dying, you know, and it's my victory against Hitler that I had children. And I think in the 90s, suddenly there was sort of this burst, and the book came out just right around Schindler's List. And like the year before Schindler's List, people would say, oh, this is a very interesting story, but it's not timely. Nobody wants to hear about the Holocaust. And Schindler's List came out, everybody wanted a Holocaust, you know. So it was very interesting what that movie did for opening this history back up.
And there are many remarkable things about the story. The first seems to me to be the sort of detail of it, that she, I've read a book about the camps where the detail of the daily life is so well caught and just kind of so relentlessly off.
Right. It's the thing I was amazed about, and Rena had an incredible memory. Really amazing memory, and there's two things I can touch on here. One, a friend of mine who was Toni Morrison's editor, Peter Dimmock, and he read the book when I wanted to make a new edition, and he got that Rena lost her mother because of the Holocaust, and they had a very, very close relationship, and she had a photograph of her mom. Because her sister had emigrated to America, who was 20 years older. So there's photos in the book of family that we would have lost otherwise. And Rena talked to her mother every day, her picture, downstairs, when I met her. And he read the book, and he said, you know, she always said, I need someone with kind eyes to tell my story. And he said, you know, you are Mama. I played the role of Mama. She wanted to tell her story to Mama. And in fact, she had Alzheimer's when she was dying of the last couple of years. And she used to pat my face and call me Mama. And I wrote a piece for NPR about that, because at first it was very confusing. And I would be like, no, you know, I'm Heather. And then I realized what a gift I could do. So I would tell her she was a good daughter, and that I loved her. I could barely speak Polish, but I could go, kocham cię. And she would pat my cheek, and I would pat hers, and I would pretend I was Mama. And I thought, I had never gotten that, you know? But he saw it. And so part of Rena's telling her story is that she wants her mother to hear the story. And I think that's why she remembered everything, she kept saying, you know, when I get home, I will tell Mama everything that happened.
And yes, and throughout the story, she invokes her mother.
She
does. All the times when she's most in danger of dying,
yeah.
then she does sort of remember the mother, to feel her presence. But the other extraordinary thing is the fact that the key to her survival is the promise she makes to her sister. And it's her sister volunteers for the work detail because
right.
she knows that Rena has gone before
right.
her, and she thinks it's the thing to do, and she thinks they're going to be all right. And they turn up in nice clothes, which is sort of another heartrending detail. They put on their best clothes because they think they'll be able to cope. So do you want to talk a bit about her relationship with Danka and what difference that made
yeah.
to her?
So Danka and Rena are completely different, right? Rena is the tiny dynamo. She was about, I think Rena might have been 5'2", which is quite tall, you know, for those. And I think Danka was 5 foot, and they might have those 2 inches up. Rena might have been 5 foot and Danka was 4'10". But Rena was a little bit bigger, very tough, very, you know, strong. They're farmer's daughters. Danka's very demure, very quiet, very sweet. She was even, you know, after Auschwitz, the first time I met Danka, I was, you know, I sat in the back of the car with her, and she spoke very softly, very sweetly. And at one point, her son was driving the car. We were going to a family gathering, and I was holding her hand, and she said, "Do you want to see it?" And she leaned over and she pulled up her 3/4 sleeve and showed me her number. And her son's driving, going, you know, like, couldn't believe that she was showing me her number. But there is this real dynamic between the two of them as sisters. They loved each other fiercely. And they often fought in freedom, and you would watch this sort of dynamic. You know, there's a scene in the new edition that we took out in the old edition where Rena talks about Papa, and whenever he sees Mama, he always pats her, he strokes her back. And if nobody's looking, he pats her bottom, right? So cute. Danka says, "I will never speak to you again if you put that in the book. Papa would never have patted Mama's behind, and you can't say that publicly because we're good Orthodox Jews." So Rena calls me crying, going, "We have to take it out. I mean, we're going to press. We have to take it out, or my sister will never speak to me again." And the editor was like, "Oh my God." So, you know, we took it out so the sisters could get along.
But the dynamic is such that Rena promises.
Yes,
that they're both going to survive.
They're both going
and
to survive.
And she promises that she won't leave her.
And they won't, or they won't die alone.
Or they won't die alone.
Yeah.
So they'll either die together or live together.
Yes.
And, I mean, when you were writing it, it's fascinating that relationship, isn't it? Because Rena is the survivor. She has all these strategies for survival. Mm-hmm. And Danka is not. And it's quite interesting to read it.
It is. We were talking earlier, Danka can be, you can feel a little frustrated with her, but she has a very important role because she allows Rena to control her. And Rena needs that. You have to remember, they're slaves. They have no control whatsoever. And Danka plays the role of allowing Rena to control her, which allows Rena to function. And without that, that very strange sort of symbiotic relationship, they don't make it. And when Rena does suffer an illness or a crisis, Danka is totally there for her. She jumps into that role immediately. But most of the time, she is, you know, sort of playing that I'm the little sister that you need to take care of. And that does something for Rena energetically that, and it's not logical, right? Rena knows that they could die at any moment, but she also knows that she must survive in order to get home to Mama and bring the baby sister back to Mama. And so, you know, we can look at it from our perspective and say this doesn't make any sense, but in terms of trauma and crisis and slavery, you will convince yourself of anything. And so it is this very, very interesting dynamic. And Danka does, you know, in many ways she appears to be very weak, and she's not at all. you know? But she does sort of allow Rena that energetic pull, like, you have to come with me, you have to do these things that end up saving their lives. I mean, they escape from Dr. Mengele, you know, it's like, you know, we're going to die anyway, come on, you know, let's walk across camp. I mean, it's extraordinary.
So that's an amazing scene. So that they're selected, that there's constant selections. You probably all know all of this, but there's constant selections. And in one of the selections, they end up in uniforms without a number on.
Yeah.
And just, do you want to just go on? So,
there's the selections for death, where, and then every once in a while, Dr. Mengele, it's usually Mengele, will come in and he's looking for work detail. And sometimes those are for, you know, an indoor job and you don't know. And so Rena straightens herself up, and she always is very, very precise. She makes sure the lines in her uniform are straight, and she puffs out her chest, and she, you know, chin up, eyes down, and she puts on, you know, like, she has her weight. She's actually, because of her sort of muscle strength, she loses a lot of weight, but she doesn't get gaunt like you would see in the traditional Auschwitz photos. And Mengele chooses her and her sister for work detail, and they realize that this is for experiments, because there are no numbers, and the dresses have aprons. And Rena, because she's also incredibly alert, sees somebody come out from behind a building with a clipboard and take somebody out of the back of the line and scratch the name off. And she goes, this is for death. Because this girl, there's girls that are scribes that have, you know, office positions, good positions, that are Jewish. They may speak German as well as Polish or Slovakian. They may have maths. So, you know, there are girls that have these good positions, and she knows. She knows she's taken a sister or a cousin out, and she looks at Donkins and takes her hand and says, we have to get out of this line, and we're going to walk and go get our uniforms across the camp, you know? And Donka's like, no, we'll get shot. And Rena's like, you know, well, we're dead anyway, so what if we get shot? And they do it, and they make it back. And that is just, you know, but Danka is terrified, and then Rena's like, you know, I will break my promise. You will not come, you know, you're choosing to die. I will die with you if you're chosen, but not if you choose. And Danka, you know, gives her hand, and, you know, just like, you know, that's really frustrating, because she won't put on her clothes. She's terrified. She's like, but, you know, I sort of get that. You get so paralyzed by fear.
And the girls who stayed in the room all died terribly.
They do, yeah. And that's an interesting bit of the history I've discovered now, is that they stopped right after that, taking women out of camp for experiments. They started taking them right off the transport. So the next group of women that are taken for experiments, and of course this is part of the final solution. They're going to sterilize Jewish women, right? And they take them right off the transport. So the next group is from a Greek transport, Greek Jews, and they stopped taking them out of camp. So there must have been a few that suddenly they went from having 50 girls to 45, or, well, we know three, and then they were like, oh, this is getting out there. You know, that you can only repress people so much before they get smart enough to try and
avoid it.
Yeah.
And that, I do think the other thing about the way Rena tells her story is that she never, there is a hopefulness to it and a constant awareness, at least retrospectively, but possibly at the time, of goodness and the goodness of people that helped her and her sister all the time. And she encounters this in all kinds of different ways,
yes.
Doesn't she? Of people, there's their work party commandant, for some reason, protects them.
Emma is amazing. And I can't find any information about Emma. Emma arrives on the first women in Auschwitz are German prisoners, and they come from Ravensbrück, and some of them are officers from Ravensbrück, female officers, and some of them are prisoners. And Emma, and they're to be the kapos, or the officers over the Jews. And Emma is a German prostitute who's been arrested and in Ravensbrück serving her term for prostitution. And there's a there's many different crimes you can have. One, you can be a political, so you're a communist or you're against the Nazi party, right? That's a good person to have that you have to work under. You, a prostitute, those are okay, some of them not. And there's the murderers. You don't want to, you do not want to be in a work detail with, you know, the murderer. So, and they all have different colored triangles. And Emma, Rena and Danka discover, are always, always, always in Emma's detail because they know she doesn't make it worse. And they form this kind of relationship. And there's this amazing moment, and it was one of my students that brought this up to me. I mean, this has been, you know, I teach this book for years now, and one of my students says to me, what do you think Emma did? So there's this moment where Rena does something, and an SS officer says her number is up. He's just beaten her, she's bloodied, she has broken ribs. And she's lying on the ground, and Emma comes racing back, and he says to Emma, this prisoner's number is up. And so, you know, Emma proceeds to kick Rena and beat her up, softer, tells her to get back to work, hands her a cloth when the SS officer is gone, clean yourself up. They arrive back at the death gate, which you've all seen, that, you know, the large gate, Birkenau, that is sort of the symbol of the Holocaust. And she's told to wait as Emma goes into the office to turn her number in. And she's watching all of the prisoners go in, the slaves, I should say, they're not prisoners, they're slaves. And the band is playing, and she knows she's dead. And Emma comes back out of the office very long after, and tells her to disappear. How up? And so I ask you guys, what do you think Emma did to save Rena's life? She gonna give a piece of bread? No. What's a prostitute do? And that's extraordinary.
Yeah, it's a remarkable act. And all along, there are just these moments, aren't there, where people who have nothing share it with someone else, yeah, including Rena herself.
Yeah.
I mean, so that all the time, that whenever they're given food at all,
always,
they share it. And not just with her sister, but with,
yeah,
I mean, that it's an incredibly sort of,
it's so beautiful. It's really, you know, and I think you don't survive this sort of experience on your own. And Rena, one of the reasons she wanted to tell her story was not just to Mama, it was to honor every single person who helped her. So Hanyuk and Bullock, they smuggle quinine when her sister has malaria, and which is a huge act to get medicine to, you know, women in Birkenau. And we don't know Hanyuk and Bullock's names. And she always, you know, she's like, if the book comes out in Polish, well, Hanyuk and Bullock, read it, know that we survived. You know, it's very, very important for her to honor every single person who helps them. And it is, I mean, I can tell you one other story. I was just in, at the 70th anniversary of the liberation of Auschwitz in January with this guy here. and we were filming the commemorative ceremonies. And afterwards, I rented a car and I drove to Tillage, where Rena is from. And I've never been to Tillage, Poland. And I was actually looking for, I was looking for two things. One is this young man who was a Gentile who Rena was in love with. And he saves her life. His name is Angie Garbera. And I'm in Tillage and I'm looking for Angie's grave. And because when he dies, Rena cannot put flowers on it, because a Jew to put flowers on a Gentile's grave is to defile the Christian and the Gentile. And I can't find it, and there's snow it's, you know, lots of snow. So you see gravestones, but trying to see the names is almost impossible. And I'm about to give up, and I feel like, you know, my 2 days walking around this tiny town, I just felt awful, you know, I felt like, oh, what a waste of a trip and everything. And as I'm leaving, I see just this little snow and this gravestone and a J. And I stop and I back up and I start filming, because I'm like, and I go and I wipe it, and it's Angie's grave. I lost it. I was just so, I was like, ugh. So I cleaned off the whole grave, and I swear to God, I heard Rena say, "Thank you, Heather," in her deep Polish voice. It was such an incredible, we have a fan page, and it's on our fan page on Facebook. It was so amazing. So Angie is like a huge part of her story to honor, you know.
Because he says it right at the start.
He does.
He's going to die.
He does.
And he's just, about 1940.
Yeah. So he was in the resistance, you know, with so many. I mean, the Poles had such a bad time between the sandwiching of Russia and Germany.
And that's, I thought the other interesting thing is that Rena and Anka, they have a different view of their religion, don't they, in the camp. So, and they have a different view. There's one of the moments when it's hard with Dango, so they're absolutely starving, and they haven't eaten anything, and they find one tiny piece of meat in the soup, and she says, "Is it pork?" and refuses to eat it, but Rena just says, "It's meat, eat it," and there is this all the time, this pull between,
push it back and forth.
Between one sister whose survival is part of, you know, observing her religion, the other who thinks that it's different, isn't it? So,
well, and after the war, Rena falls in love with a Gentile and actually converts to Catholicism, and Danka keeps kosher and marries a Jewish resistance fighter. And so we have, in the family, we have the Gentile side of the family and we have the Jewish side of the family. And that is maintained today. And sometimes a Gentile family will call me up and say, "Well, how do we do this?" Jewish side of the family, I'm the advisor.
But there is this point where they've been in the camp for 2 years, I think, and then there's the moment where Rena just feels there is no God, that she has a really black moment.
She does, and Danka does not go through that. And this is that moment where Rena loses her faith entirely, and it comes from a prayer that she gives, and it's as children, she's seeing children go to the gas chamber, and it is a moment in my research where I'm trying to figure out, you know, Rena has no calendar for any of these things that are happening, but the Auschwitz Chronicles give us the day-to-day of what happens in Auschwitz, and I would go through page by page, you know, say, was it cold out, you know, try to find this information, and I finally find that in January 30th and January 31st in 1943, she says, there's 500 children going to the gas chamber. It's just extraordinary. There it is, 500 children going to the gas chamber. And then the day after, it's 498. And, it's like, this feeling of cold water washing through you going, oh my God, it's here. This is the date. These are the children. And as Rena's seeing that, she prays that just one SS be smited. Don't forget us, Lord. Just kill one SS and show me that you're still alive and that you haven't forgotten us. And it doesn't happen. In fact, instead, SS Hasse, who is Drexler's sister, Drexler is one of, she's actually hung later in the Nuremberg trials, and SS Hasse comes up and sort of spits in Rena's face and says, "Where is your God now?" And that's it for Rena. No more God. That's it. What I can give you as an audience is that when the book came out, I called Rena up, and she was showing it to Mama on the wall, and she was weeping. And I said, "I think God's a little late. Well, I know God's a little late, but I think your prayer has just been answered." And this book was an answer to her prayer. Absolutely. It has, as part of truth and changing people's knowledge of this history and acceptance, it's a huge part of the answer to her prayer, which I think is really powerful.
And also, that just talk very briefly, the foundation, had a foundation in Rena's name, and that's another part of the answer to prayers.
It is, yeah. We work with young people Because Rena only had an 8th grade education, and she didn't, she wasn't, you know, she spoke 5 languages, but not English. She wasn't a writer. So she needed somebody to tell her story for her. And so we work with teenagers who, the importance of having a voice and acknowledging your story, and so we work across socioeconomic status. We've had a young man from South Africa come, a Welsh girl, farm girl, came, Georgie, and so we have this wonderful creative writing camp. One of my students is, you know, I've had a student who was homeless in New York, another who's a gunshot victim, that we encourage them to write and get their truth out there, because our voices are important, especially young people, and we, and that's part of what the foundation does, yeah, to reach back. Yeah.
And we've got 15 minutes left, I think, so can we put the lights up so we can see and see if there are any questions? Yes?
How did they get to America?
Oh, sorry.
I'm Shirley Hopkins. How did they get to America?
So it was actually in the 50s. Gertrude is the eldest sister, and she emigrated before the war. There's another sister who we don't know what happens to, who had 2 children, so we can guess what happened to her. And Donka and Rena, it's right as the Cold War begins, and they're in Holland, and Rena has 3 children, and she looks at her husband and says, "I can't raise children in Europe. Take me to America." She's terrified of the Cold War, and Danka follows her. So they raise the children in, John, they start in Connecticut. Danka and Ellie end up in Queens, New York, which has a large kosher population. They stay there, but John, Rena's husband, is an educator, and so they travel quite a bit. They go to Maine and Montana. But they raise their children here, and that was the reason. It was right in the early 50s. Yeah.
And it's nice how she meets him, isn't it? How she meets her husband, because that's really as soon as they're liberated.
It is. It's so many people find their partners after liberation. And John, it's one of the things that we think nowadays, you come back from war and you go to a hospital or you get therapy and PTSD, and we all know these wonderful terms that back then nobody had any of those things. And the only way that Rena and her sister and some other girls, they have been freed from Neustadt Gleva, which is the interior of Germany, and it's one of the satellite camps of Ravensbrück. So Ravensbrück was completely overcrowded. And this probably saved their lives, being taken to Neustadt Gleva. They were starved, but it was not a death camp. And there was actually a lot of Gentiles there, and I've met several who were from Auschwitz that were in Ravensbrück. They're Gentiles who also survived, and actually end up going back to Poland. But so Rena and her sister and some friends, they go to Holland, and immediately they have no papers. So nobody knows what to do with these people, you know. You don't have, there's no passports, you know, no ID papers, so they want to send them back to Germany. And the girls are terrified. They fall on their knees and they cry and they beg this American major not to send them back to Germany. And there's this kind Dutchman who says, works for the Red Cross, and says, "I can give them jobs." And he gives them jobs, and that ends up being Rena's husband. The important part of all of that is that John and Rena love to dance, okay. And every Saturday night they used to dance together, even when she was in a wheelchair. And there's the little line there about, you know, that he would take them to dances and help them become real women again, and he danced with everybody, but he danced twice as much with me. And it was still true. She loved to
dance. It is, I mean, that actually it is shocking. You have these people who survived 3 years, 41 days. They've been to Auschwitz, they've been to on the death march, they've been to, and nobody knows what to do with them. And nobody sort of showers them with love or attention or anything. They are just,
no, it's a burden.
Yeah, abandoned in Europe. It's fascinating.
But it's a little bit what we deal with refugees today. Yeah. It's like, what do we do with you? Yeah. You know, like, we don't know. I mean, it's a very difficult situation. Because you sort of want people to go back to Poland. If you're from Poland, go there. And of course, has anybody been to Poland here? So you know, gosh, a lot of you, yeah. I mean, you walk through Krakow, there's no Jews. All of the synagogues are museums. You go there on the Sabbath, and it's a museum, and it's really sad. It's just like, they're gone. And I have, this last trip, after I found Andrzej Garbera's grave, I went to find what happened to Mama and Papa, and the book had come out. We did not know. But when I was at the 70th anniversary, the head of the Judaica Foundation, which is an amazing foundation in Krakow that is, what we're talking about in Poland is not just genocide, we're talking about culture side. So the Nazis wanted to erase all cultural contributions that Jews made, scientific, art, music, everything, philosophy. And so the Judaica Foundation is by Gentiles, of course, and they are enriching Polish culture by going back into history and pulling out what was erased and giving Poland back their Jewish culture. It's an incredible organization. Well, I told the head of it that I was heading to Tillage, and one of the things I was looking for was Mama and Papa, who are Sarah and Heim Kornreich, were last seen in the Gribo ghetto. And then they may have gone to Novosadsk, which these are all sort of little towns. Novosadsk, they might have been seen there, but it's all sort of sketchy. And he says to me, don't go to Gribo. Go to Novosadsk. That was a much larger ghetto, and Gribo was liquidated. And which is a good thing, because there was a snowstorm coming, and I was trying to go to Gribo, and I went, I'm never going to make it. I'm going to get stuck in the mountains, and and I don't speak Polish. So I turned around, and I went to Novosadsk, and sure enough, I found the ghetto, the population list of the ghetto, and there was Mama and Papa's names on it. I believe they were executed within a week or two that Rena and Danka were sent to Auschwitz, and they were executed in the Jewish graveyard in Novosadsk with Gentiles who supported their business partners, their Jewish business partners, and the elders of the ghetto and the Gentiles who refused to bow to the Nazis were all executed together. They did two executions within a couple of weeks.
Young daughters that I want to teach about the Holocaust, how old do you think they need to be to hear this type of story? I know there's lots of books written for younger.
Right. I get 12 to 14. I mean, people in Britain read at a much earlier age. I was really into the Holocaust about 10 to 12. And I do think one of the things that I do, you'll find me on Twitter sometimes on a Sunday night, sort of encouraging kids will be like going, oh, I have to do my Holocaust homework, and I'll be like, good for you, Rena loves you, Rena would be so great, and they get like really excited, like, oh my God, there's somebody who is encouraging me to do it. But I always try to give the positive perspective. I think so much of Holocaust, the kids get really tired of being beaten down with the horror, and it was horrible, absolutely. But you know what? Every single person that helped Rena and her sister live, every single person who survived had those people. So there are millions of people that came out and risked their lives and maybe died to help somebody else. And that, to me, that's our humanity. And I think that's an essential part of the story. And often, you can read these stories, there's a couple of, I've done a lot of the research, I just feel like vomiting, and I just like, and Rena, when she was writing her book, I'd call her up and I'd go, I'm doing some research, Rena, do we need to say this? She'd go, ugh, I don't want my readers to know that. So there were things she wouldn't put in there, because she didn't want to horrify you more than you needed to be horrified, she didn't want it to be gratuitous, and she really wanted you to know about the piece of bread that came, those were the important things. And so I think that perspective is essential for young people. Otherwise, it's just a negative narrative, and you feel sort of hopeless. One of the things that we were doing in Auschwitz, which is an amazing town outside of Auschwitz, and if you've been to Auschwitz and you go to Auschwitz, you will there's a wonderful Jewish museum there, and that has relics. I mean, the Jewish neighborhood has been obliterated, the great synagogue, but there's a small synagogue, and there's a priest. There's a monument to a priest who was sent to Auschwitz for caring for his rabbi friends. It's a really sort of extraordinary story of this town. We were staying at a center that is created by Germans for German reparation, and they bring young people from Germany in high school, college, and they do a program. And they go to Auschwitz and they come to the center and they're able to talk about their feelings, their experience, and the educators that are working with these young people that are very interesting. They said, we do not criticize them at all. If they don't feel anything, that's okay. They can say, I didn't feel anything, you know. So once again, that you have to have that educational support to be where you are in this history, you know. Mm-hmm. Not everybody, some kids were going to be sobbing and some aren't, and that's okay, right? That's where you are, and that's how we educate. We support young people to go through this process, and it's an amazing center that we were at working with.
Somebody over here, I think, the microphone.
Yes.
There's currently a former SS NCO from Auschwitz on trial in Germany, Walter Gröning. I wonder if you had a view about this process of putting very elderly possible war criminals on trial.
Yeah, I do. I think you have to be held accountable. I do. I don't know if that's a popular view, but if he's truly guilty, I mean, it's one of the things that was a little unnerving for me when I was at the 70th anniversary, as I discovered that the grandson of Dr. Mengele was there, and they were outside. They weren't invited into the main tent, which you think these tents are big. This was 2,000 people. And it covered the entire death gate into Birkenau. It was huge. Spielberg was there. It was lit like a movie set. But there was an outside area, and the grandson of Göring were there. Göring was there. Mengele and Commandant Hess, and I know they have, you know, these are grandchildren, and they have a right to be there. But it created quite a problem for some of the survivors, and so we tried to sort of protect survivors from knowing that, and it's very complicated, you know, it's very, very complicated. Those are grandchildren, you know, they are the innocents. But someone who was actually involved, I think they should be held accountable.
I'm afraid. One more.
Yeah.
Okay,
one more.
I might get shouted.
You can ask me later.
Quick question. I'll get shouted at.
Just following on from what you just said about the grandchildren. Did you, in your research, ever interview the families of the Germans, the Nazis?
I did not. This is a memoir, so I focused on Rena's story. Absolutely. It is Rena's story. The research is based on the calendar of her experience, so there's footnotes underneath that tell you when what was happening outside in the real world that she didn't know. But no, this is really my focus. My research is the first women, because this is women's rights, this is human rights. We have a huge problem in this world where women, if you want to get rid of a race of people, you get rid of women first, right? That's what you do. And that has borne out through history, and I think that this is essential that we understand this so that we can protect women.
And Rena's Promise by Rena Corrie-Gleason.
Yeah.
It is a wonderful memoir. I would say that if you're daughters or teenagers, they could read it. I mean, it's an inspiring and hopeful book, and Heather will be signing it in the bookshop afterwards. So all that remains for me to do is thank you for coming.
Thank you
for talking.